Hello, everybody. Tracy Mrs. J-Dog Flanagan with you here today. I'm the co-founder and senior vice president of J-Dog Brands. Welcome back to another exciting episode of Tactical Treasures Podcast, sponsored by the J-Dog Foundation. Our podcast gives veterans, male spouses, active military members, and military family members a voice in the veteran space to speak about their service, how they're affecting their communities post-service, and they share with me a tactical treasure that has shaped their journey in their military career, business, or life. Today, I am excited and have the pleasure of speaking with SMA Michael Grinston. SMA Grinston served 36 years in the Army and had the distinction of being named the 16th Sergeant Major of the Army, the highest ranking enlisted soldier, and the Army Chief of Staff's personal advisor on quality of life issues. As of 2024, SMA Grinston serves as the CEO of Army Emergency Relief and sees his role at AER as a continuation of his commitment to soldiers and their families. AER's mission strongly aligns with Grinston's purpose of bringing stability to soldiers in need. In his former leadership roles, he saw firsthand the issues that can stem from strained financial situations, suicide, domestic violence, and food insecurity, to name a few. As Sergeant Major of the Army, he advocated for change in many areas that also overlap with services provided by AER. SMA Grinston championed issues such as housing, helping to secure over $1 billion a year to enhance living quarters. He began a worldwide quarterly meeting to improve overall food nutrition in the Army, as well as modernizing facilities where soldiers eat. SMA Grinston holds a Bachelor of Arts degree in Business Administration, and his military education includes all levels of the non-commissioned officer education system. He is a graduate of Ranger, Airborne, Drill Sergeant, and Air Assault schools. SMA Grinston's deployments included 6 combat tours in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Saudi Arabia, as well as an operational tour in Kosovo. He also served on the boards of the Army and Air Force Exchange Services and the Defense Commissary Agency. Hello, SMA Grinston. What an amazing bio. Thank you for joining me today. I'm excited for our discussion, and thank you so much for your service, sir.
No, thanks, Tracy. Thanks for having me, and thanks for reading that whole bio. I wanted to stop you about halfway through, but I was like, I just cut it off. But no, thank you.
Yes, of course. So what an amazing career in the Army you've had. So I would love to know what inspired you to join the Army.
It's really not very complicated. And most people go, oh, you saw this thing. Actually, it wasn't too much. It might've been, you know, serendipity. I just happened to be home from college and the recruiter called me and said, hey, you know, we could give you a whole bunch of money to finish your college. And I was successful. I wasn't making bad grades, not great grades. And it just happened to call. And I was like, well, maybe I could try this thing and go in the Army for a couple of years, have money. I wouldn't have to struggle to get through and try to find ways to get into college. So believe it or not, it's just a recruiter happened to call me while I was on a summer break from my college. And I think I always had something in there that said, yeah, I'd like to do some kind of service, but I just didn't do it. And then he said, yeah, do this. And 36 years later,
here you are. I've heard many times that, you know, people just join up for a couple years and all of a sudden 20 years later they're still in. So that's all the time. So is there a particular aspect or moment from your service that stood out as impactful in a positive way?
Well, there's so many.
I know.
It's really hard to narrow that down to one impactful moment. I could just say one impactful position, you know, Sergeant Major of the Army. That's pretty cool. So, and just being able to help people, you know, at a level and that I'd never seen before, even for me, it was just great. And I could just give you just one quick story and how impactful. We just deployed our first brigade of 3rd Infantry Division. They went over to deploy to Europe. Russia just invaded Ukraine, you know, 2 years ago. And this woman came up to me and said, my husband We just got back from Korea. That unit was on a rotation deployment to Korea. Then you came back and they deployed to Europe. He's gone. And then he's on assignment when he gets back from that to go without me to go to Korea. And she says, I just want my husband back.
Oh.
And as the sergeant major of the army, I go, well, that's easy. We'll just delete the orders. And they go, is it that easy? I'm like, yeah, actually it is. So if you're not the sergeant major of the army, probably a lot harder.
Right.
But yeah, those are the moments, and that's the things I could do as a sergeant major of the army that just made a difference for one individual. But those are families behind those
Sure.
decisions, and that's just one of those stories I remember. But there's thousands of
Yeah, I'm
those
sure.
that I
Yeah.
had.
Wow, amazing. Yeah, I guess you do have a lot of power. That's and it's good. That's a good thing. Yeah, I know. Families do sacrifice a lot as well, supporting their service member. So, definitely. Now you're CEO of AER, which is the Army Emergency Relief Fund, which I have to tell you, I never knew existed until in preparation for this podcast. I did a lot of research and I thought, wow, this is amazing. I've never heard of this before. So I would love to know what the journey was to becoming the CEO. And obviously, love to talk about the work that you're all doing there.
Yeah, first of all, I really enjoy my job. It really feels like a continuation of what I was doing as the sergeant major of the army and all the other positions I had. It's just helping people is what I enjoy so much. And how did I get here? And it really is framed with a funny statement that I made when I was taking over. As the CEO, I was meeting with a small group, and I was like, man, if I had known retirement was this good, I would have done it a long time ago. And somebody turns to me and says, well, if you'd retired a long time ago, you might not be in the job that you're in now.
True.
So how did I get here? I think what got me here was a long time commitment to service and continuously trying to make myself better over time through finishing my degree, continuously pushing myself and those others around me to do better and do what's right for the Army, and then educating myself, reading books and trying to get to those positions, and then you rise up to the military. And I think my success in the military helped me transition to be the first enlisted to become the CEO of the Army Emergency Relief. So I think it was a 3.5 decades of military service at the leadership levels that I was at, and continuously trying to improve myself that enabled me to get to the job that I'm in now.
Wow, that's incredible. So AER, I've read that have 30 plus, services for, and this is strictly for Army soldiers and families, correct? Okay.
Yeah.
Just give me a little synopsis of what you all do and what you provide for the soldiers and their families.
I like to say we have one area of assistance, which drives my assistance people insane. So basically, we provide financial stability, or soldiers that need financial assistance, we provide those funds to those families. It's active duty and guard and reserve. If a Army National Guard and Army Reserve soldier that's been on status, meaning they're routinely going into Army work, not their other job, for over 30 days, we provide them financial assistance in the time of need. And that's where I say we have one category is like one, if they need assistance and they need financial assistance, they should ask for help. And we break that down into 30 categories, but one example would be, and this is a heart-wrenching story, and I get one a
Oh,
week,
sure.
one of these stories. And this was the one is we had a soldier, and it was a newborn that died.
Oh, dear.
And we paid the insurance money right up front. There's burial costs, there's all these costs. They were going to get some life insurance, but we came in and said, immediately, here's the money. if you get, life insurance back, you can pay us back. If you don't, we'll probably write it off anyway. And then we said, here's money for the plane tickets. That's just one of those things that we do in assistance, where if you have something so bad that happens in your family, why would we want to compound that with a financial
Right,
debt?
right.
That's just horrible. So that's what we do. We try to raise money in order to give those soldiers and their families that peace of mind that if they go through a financial hardship, that the Army Emergency Relief is going to be there for them so that they can actually be a ready soldier, so that when they're out there in Poland or if they're in Iraq or Syria protecting the nation, they don't have to worry about this thing that might have caused them financial worry, and they can come to Army Emergency Relief and we try to give them the money that they need to alleviate that
Right.
stress.
So how did they go about that? Do they apply? Is there an application process or?
Yes, there is an application process, and there's multiple ways you can go. And most people don't know this, is you can actually go to American Red Cross if you have an emergency and said, oh no, something happened. I'll give you the example is I think December, January, tornadoes go through Nashville, and we had a recruiter literally loses their whole house and they got to go live in a hotel because their house is
Right.
gone and they don't live near a base. And it's like, hey, how can I get help from AER? You can actually go to American Red Cross. And somebody goes, oh, I'm really glad American Red Cross gave me the money. Actually, it's not true. Army Emergency Relief, they give them the money on our behalf, and they bill us, and then we just give them the money. So you can go to any Red Cross worldwide and say, I need assistance, an emergency, an American Red Cross. They'll validate that with us. So that's number one. We actually have a armyemergencyrelief.org. There is a website. There's an application over. There's a donation button in the middle. On the left, there's an application. You click that, you can apply there. And then the third way is Red Cross. The third, you can go to any base where you have a soldier, any base, Navy, Marine,
Oh,
Army.
okay.
We have agreements with the Navy Marine Corps Society. We have agreement with the Coast Guard Society. So even if you're Army and you're not near an Army base, you can go to one of those relief societies, you fill out an application, and then it'll come to us eventually, and then we'll provide the funds if they
Oh,
qualify.
wow. Wow, that's great. I understand that one of the services that you help with is food insecurities, and I've kind of heard about that a lot, that is happening to our men and women who are serving, that their families struggle with food insecurity, and that's terrible. Again, is that an application process that they would provide and say, my family's struggling.
Yeah, it's the same application process. Anytime they're in need, and especially if you can't put food on the table for whatever reason, normally it doesn't look like food insecurity, though, in my
Okay.
opinion. It's more like I'm sitting there, I've got a family, something happened, my water heater went out, and I can't afford, the water heater, but I still have to feed my family.
Okay.
So we don't want to have them in that
Sure.
dilemma. It's like we come in and help with the water heater so that you can still feed your
Right.
family. But we actually do have a category that says food insecurity. If they're struggling with food, they can always come to us and then we'll provide them assistance. But a lot of our assistance is when you look at if I can't pay my rent, I mean, that's the same thing. I have to live
Right.
somewhere. Do I pay my rent or do I buy food? But we specifically have a category that says if you're struggling with food, come see us, fill out the application, we'll get you some money. But even if all those other categories, in my opinion, help with food
Hello,
insecurity.
viewers and listeners. I would like to introduce you to the J-Dog Foundation, which is a 501c3 nonprofit dedicated to the prevention of veteran suicide and the healing of veterans' mental health. 100% of all proceeds received by the J-Dog Foundation goes directly to several foundations focused on the mission of saving veterans' lives. Each partner is hand-selected by our executive director, Jerry Flanagan, with input from the assistant director, Tracy Flanagan, and the J-Dog Foundation board members. Our foundation's motto, saving lives, one veteran at a time. Go to jdogfoundation.org to take a look at everything that we're doing there and the organizations that we're partnered with. You can also donate, and there's also a support line if you're in need of help. Thanks. Check us out. jdogfoundation.org.
Right. So are there like civilians that volunteer within Army Emergency Relief to help? Or no, is it strictly just financial funding?
Yeah, it's strictly financial funding, except for the one volunteer. We have one volunteer in the headquarters. She comes in on Monday. Amy, she's a wonderful person. Our son's in the Army. So we don't normally have like, hey, I'd like to come volunteer for Army Emergency Relief. I would say if you want to do that, there's a lot of volunteer things you can do around the installations.
Okay.
And I think that's where you can go in and say, hey, I'd like to do this thing for whatever reason.
All right, great. And people can donate, like if they, you know, are watching this podcast and they think, wow, this is really cool, I want to support, can they go online and donate?
Yeah, the same thing. It's all one little website. You go armyemergencyrelief.org. And in the middle, instead of going for the assistance button on the left, the donations button in the middle, you click on the donations. And then you can go through, I think we've got PayPal in there. You can do an ACH. You can do credit card. There's a few ways that you can pay and donate through the website right there. So we really appreciate all those donations.
That's great. Awesome. I would love to know your tactical treasure. What are you going to share with us today?
I know. I thought about this. My tactical treasure is somehow I convinced my wife to marry me. So
that's a tactical treasure. That works for me.
Yeah. But 28 years ago we got married. We met. We were dating 3 years before that. So, you know, why have I been successful? Is I just had a wonderful spouse that's been supportive for me for 31 years, whichever number you want to use, and two wonderful daughters that I ripped in out of schools 11 times.
My gosh.
So my daughters had moved 11 times before they went off to college, lived in, three or four different countries, and supported me through all that, all those combat deployments that I have in 5 years. So I guess my tactical treasure is my family still stuck with me, especially my wife. And she's really kept me grounded. Anytime I think I'm, too good to take out the trash, she reminds me, like, hey, let's go do it. And while you're there, why don't you go in the kitchen, start cooking, if you want to eat. I'm really been lucky and blessed with a wonderful family that has supported me. And I don't think I would have been this Army. And I don't think I would be the CEO of AER if it wasn't for my wife. She's has been there for a long time, supporting me every step of the way. And I do tell people it's not always, fireworks and parades in marriage. There'll be ups and downs. There's arguments. I'm not going to lie about that, but there's clearly been more good than bad. And it's a loving family. And I wouldn't be where I'm at today without them.
That's awesome. I love that. That's a very special tactical treasure. And, service members, they count on that supportive family unit. When you think about it, the family serves too. And many sacrifices, but many gains in the process, I think. So I love our male spouses and our military brats. They're resilient and courageous and strong, and they do amazing things in support of their service members. So I love hearing that. I'm sure your wife is an amazing woman, as well as your children. So hats off to you guys. So that's really quite a blessing and a great treasure. So I have to ask, and I always ask this of everybody that I have on, you know, veterans constantly struggle with transition. It doesn't matter how long they serve, but I think it's even more difficult when they serve, you know, for 10, 20 years, or they've just went in service right out of high school and, you know, they get out and all of a sudden they're an adult and they have to try to figure out what their next step in life is. And a lot of times there's identity crisis that goes along with that too. So would you have any words of advice for your fellow veterans that may struggle?
Yeah, I got a lot of advice. I don't think we got, you know, time for all of it. Matter of fact, I actually started posting like little things as I was going through my transition on LinkedIn, and people were like, that was incredible. The one they liked the most is the job I didn't get. So I was like, wow. It's like, yeah, I posted, hey, I interviewed for another CEO job, and like, and I said, well, I didn't even get like a second interview. And, you know, I had people calling me like, oh, you're going to be okay. I wasn't sad. It was just, you know, for me, it was exciting. I wanted to go through the process. I wanted to fill out my resume and apply and do something like that, because that's what our soldiers were doing. And I'm like, why wouldn't I do that? Why, you know, why am I trying to do this? So when I didn't get a job, I mean, the internet went crazy. They're like, oh, that's, you know, and then my phone blew up. Are you okay? I'm like, yeah, it's like, I retired to Sergeant Major Army. There wasn't a lot of worries, but you know, people really enjoyed hearing me fail, I guess. But
you were an inspiration. So
I was an inspiration.
You weren't the only ones.
Yeah. And then they were like, oh no, if this guy doesn't get a job, you know, there's no hope for the rest of this. Is, you know, some of that comment too. But I think for me is be bold. Don't afraid to try. And I just look at this job I have now. I'm the first enlisted there to be the CEO for the Army Emergency Relief. But that was something I really wanted to do. It's always been, you know, held by a retired general officer, and we'd never done it before. But I wasn't afraid to apply. I wasn't afraid to apply the other job. And the second thing, I wasn't afraid to tell people I didn't get it. So my biggest advice is, you know, don't be afraid to fail. And a lot of times we're just afraid of this unknown as you transition. You got the warm, fuzzy blanket of the Army, and, you know, you're going to get paid most of the time, you know, every month or twice a month. So it's very predictable. And then all of a sudden you're in this unpredictable thing, and you're afraid that, I may fail, so you don't even try. So number one is just try, and if it, you know, you fail, you get up and you go, yep, I did it, and then go do it again, and then do it again, and do it again, and then you might end up in like the best job ever, although I'm holding it, so I'm sorry, I don't plan on leaving anytime, but that's number one. Don't be afraid to try something, and don't be afraid of the process. And a lot of people just have this anxiety of just getting out. And I know it's easy to say, don't be afraid and don't try something. There's going to be, you know, this fear of the unknown, but just jump on in. And that's probably the biggest advice I can give you. And for those retiring, if you've been really busy and really active, you better find like three or four hobbies. So that's number two. I think my wife was going to kill me at some point. We have three bathrooms in our house. I remodeled two at the same time.
And a house of three women. Oh no. That didn't go well, right?
It's like, you need to get a job. And here's another famous quote in my transition was, I figured it out. It wasn't the Army, it was you.
So, good.
Don't slow down is the next advice. It's, you know, I wanted to take some time off. I took about 3 months, and I agree with that. But who I am was, I'm active. I wanted to stay active. I didn't want the screeching halt. You know, when you're busy and you're go, go, go as the Sergeant Major Army, and it was go, go, go. It's like, It took a while to get to a new pace, but I didn't want to, I didn't, clearly I didn't slow down, just started destroying my house. But I was really happy with that. I stayed really active. I'm still running, I'm exercising. So some of those things I'm still doing, and I feel really good. I feel energized. But it is a process. And the last thing I would say is be patient. You know, keep trying, be bold, but be patient. I think it'll come. The transition will be there. And after a few months, you're just going to be sitting there smiling and happy. If you prepare, if you just go into it blindly, I think, well, you know, we never do that in the Army. So why in the world would you try that when you transition? Prepare for your transition but be patient and be bold, and then it'll be fine.
Great advice. Yeah, I love it. That's all you do in the Army is prepare, right? You have to do it in real life too.
Yeah, I know. It's like getting out of the Army. And it's like, oh, you just got out. It's like, well, you didn't plan. It's like, yeah, you know, I can't imagine. I'm like, okay, well, all the other times in the Army, that still applies. And that'd probably be another thing too, is like all that stuff you learned in the Army actually, a lot of times actually applies. You may have to say it differently. Right. But a lot of things I'm learning that, you know, when I was in the Army, it just kind of applies. You just got to say it a different way. It looks a little different. It's a different word. But, you know, in the end, I go, yeah, man, I was doing that the whole time. So this is just a little different.
That's great advice. Yeah. Plan. I love it. So before you go, can you tell us where people can find and connect with you and where they can find out more information about AER?
Yeah. Clearly connected with me. I've already said it. I am on LinkedIn. And for those who are wondering that all of a sudden there's this mysterious thing on Facebook, I actually did get a Facebook account for the first time ever.
Oh, good so, for you.
Yeah, I know.
I know.
Yeah. It's like, why didn't you have Facebook before? Because, you know, at some point, you know, the Army is a young, you know, person's game. And we said, well, Facebook's for old people. So for everybody that has Facebook account, don't come after me. So I got a Facebook account. You can connect with me down there. It'll show my picture of AER. And then I have one on Twitter that's just a little meme. So I'm trying to change it up because I had a whole bunch of fake those. So I'm on Twitter. I'm on Facebook. But you can ultimately just get michael.grinston@aerheadquarters.org. And that's how you can reach out to me. And if you want any information, it's the same website I've given you probably three or four times now, armyemergencyrelief.org, all one word, all lower caps. All our information is right there on the website. You can find out all the information you want, or you can contact me personally and we'll get you the information
there. Okay, that's great. Thank you so much for coming on. I know you're a busy man. I appreciate everything that you shared with us today, sir. It was amazing to talk to you.
No, Tracy, thanks for having me. And I have enjoyed my career, and I enjoy my new career now. And like I said, I just love helping soldiers and their families with any financial assistance that we can provide them. Just brings a joy to me every
day. Well, you're definitely doing amazing work there. So thank you so much for that. And thank you for coming on, sir.
No, thank you.
Hello, viewers and listeners. Thank you so much for tuning into this episode of Tactical Treasures Podcast. We've just finished up an amazing conversation with SMA Grinston, who served 36 years in the Army and had the distinction of being named the 16th Sergeant Major of the Army, and now is the CEO of the Army Emergency Relief, or AER, which is the official nonprofit of the U.S. Army, having been supporting soldiers and their families since 1942. The mission of Army Emergency Relief is to provide grants, interest-free loans, and scholarships to promote readiness and help relieve financial distress for soldiers, retirees, and their families. Through the generosity of their donors, soldiers have the peace of mind knowing AER will be there for them during times of need. AER has 30-plus categories of assistance. Some of these categories include basic living expenses, such as housing, food insecurities, and utilities, personal transportation, auto repairs and maintenance, emergency emergency travel and disasters, which are funeral travel expenses, hurricanes, typhoons, tornadoes, education scholarships for spouses, children, and the Pentagon Victims Program, career skills program, which are grants for soldiers transitioning out of the Army, and other categories such as relocation expenses, medical and dental expenses. In 2023, AER supported more than 31,000 soldiers and families, awarded more than 3,085 scholarships, and helped more than 2,000 Army families with more than $1.3 million in disaster relief. The goal of AER is to ensure that soldiers do not have the burden of worrying about financial issues while they are protecting Americans around the world. To learn more, to support, and donate, go to armyemergencyrelief.org. To reach out to SMA Grinston, you can find him on LinkedIn or you can email him at michael.grinston@aerhq.org. Again, thanks for joining us. Don't forget, you can find Tactical Treasures podcast on all your favorite podcast platforms, as well as Vet TV and American Grit. We are now airing on Reese Across America Radio on Thursdays at 7 p.m. Eastern. And if you miss that, please join us for the encore on Saturdays at 1 p.m. Eastern. You can also find Reese Across America Radio on the iHeartRadio app, the Odyssey app, and the TuneIn app. We are also proud to share that our JDog Foundation is a Reese Across America sponsorship group. For each $17 Veterans Wreath you sponsor, $5 goes directly back to the JDog Foundation, whose mission is to prevent veteran suicide and heal veterans' mental health and PTSD. You can donate right now at reeseacrossamerica.org/JDog. Thanks for tuning in. We'll see you again on another podcast real soon. Bye-bye now.